Go ahead.
All right, thank you. Good evening, folks, and welcome to the Benton Town Council meeting for this Tuesday evening, September 17th. Certainly good to see all of you, and we'll start with the roll call, please.
Councilmember Lyles?
Here.
Councilmember McCarty?
Here.
Councilmember Mullins?
Here.
Vice Mayor Stovall?
Here.
Mayor Gross?
Here. Thank you, ma'am. Obviously, we have a quorum. All right, as always, we will start with a moment of silence, which we use here in the town of Benton so that everyone can pray or meditate as they see fit. In your thoughts and prayers this evening, I hope you will keep this country, this community, and this council meeting in your prayers. I'll certainly be praying. I hope you will. And before that, we will have the Pledge of Allegiance. Who's going to do that this afternoon, Keith?
I have my new friend Claire going to do that tonight.
All right.
All right, Claire.
I'm glad to know that you have a new friend.
That's not only two.
All right. So, Claire, if you want to come up here, you can. All right, we'll all stand up. Whenever Claire is ready, we'll start. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Good job. Good job. Say what?
Can we give Cole a pin?
Oh. Yes, good
absolutely.
Idea.
My gift card is still coming.
Claire, if you want to come back up, we got a special gift for you, and it looks like you got your sister with you, right? This is a special good idea. Thank you.
Oh, well, that was Keith. I'm going to give that. I'll recognize him.
Thank you.
Thanks, Claire. Right. So, first, you guys learn to pledge. I might give you a pen. Oh, goodness. Where are we, folks? Okay. I guess we will move on to the community events and announcements. Mm-hmm. Councilmember McCarty, please.
Yes. Let's see. We have October the 12th. Wait a minute. September the 28th. We have a mingle. And that's Fuzzy Logic and Rock and Roll Diner Food Truck. And that's from 7 to 10 at the Farmers Market. Then October the 12th, we have the Vinton Fall Festival. That is from 10 to 4, and that's downtown. October the 14th, the town offices will be closed in observance of Columbus Day. October the 26th, the Shred event at the War Memorial from 10 to 1. And October 29th, the downtown trick-or-treating in downtown Vinton. It starts at 3. And we also encourage you to visit one of the many restaurants and entertainment venues in our community, visit their website and on social media. And for more information on everything happening in Vinton, please visit the In Vinton Facebook page and don't forget to like and share.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate that. Councilmember Mullins, you usually cover the council activities.
Yes, sir. And I was going to apologize that it be in the McCarty and Mullins show on this edition, but I mean, I'm not going to apologize because we did some fun stuff.
All right.
September 4th, she and I attended the Pink Warrior Committee meeting. And on the 7th was the Pink Warrior Walk. And on September 11th, she and I attended Public Works Committee meeting. And then on September 16th, Mayor Gross and Vice Mayor Stovall attended finance, the finance committee meeting.
All right.
That's it.
All right. Thank you. Well, I'm glad we got at least one mention.
Put you there at the end.
All right. Thank you for that. All right. Next thing is a request to postpone or change the order of the agenda, staff or council. Hearing none, we'll move on to the consent agenda, which tonight contains the minutes of the regular meeting of September 3rd, 2024. Are there any changes or additions? Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion for approval.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a couple of seconds. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same side. All right. Now the fun part of the evening, our awards and presentation. And, of course, this is Constitution Week. We have with us a couple of members of the Daughters of the American Revolution. And we also have a proclamation, which Council Member McCarty will read. And I'll give you an opportunity to come forward and say a few words if you'd like. But if you'll go ahead with the proclamation, please.
Okay. Whereas September the 17th, 2024, marks the 237th anniversary of the drafting of the Constitution of the United States of America by the Constitutional Convention, and whereas it is fitting and proper to accord official recognition to this magnificent document and its memorable anniversary, and to the patriotic celebrations which will commemorate the occasion, and whereas Public Law 915 guarantees the issues of a proclamation each year by the President of the United States of America designating September the 17th through the 23rd as Constitution Week. Now, therefore, Mayor Bradley E. Gross and the Town Council, on behalf of the Town of Vinton and all our citizens, do hereby proclaim this week of September the 17th through the 23rd as Constitution Week.
Thank you. If you will come on up, we will take a note.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Did you folks want to say anything? No. Okay. I got you. All right. We'll move to police department. Chief Drummond, I understand you got some stuff this evening.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'll invite Deputy Chief Wallace, and I will join him up at the podium.
Mr. Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of the council, it is my distinct honor to introduce to you guys our newest officer to the Vinton Police Department, Jacob Miller. To give you a little background on Officer Miller, he was born in 1986 in South Carolina. He is a graduate from Glenver High School, which he graduated from in 2004. He then went to the Air Force and served 4 years from 2004 to 2008, which at that point, after his service, he moved back home, met his beautiful wife, Ashley. He has two wonderful daughters, Claire, who is 10, and Campbell, who is 7. At that time, he got hired on with the Salem Police Department. He worked 12 and a half incredible years with the Salem Police Department, moving up the ranks. He worked as a patrol officer, a detective supervisor, and also a supervisor over services. During that time, he also was able to get a master's degree from Liberty University. He graduated from the National Criminal Justice Command College, and he also graduated from Virginia Department of Forensic Science Academy. In his spare time, he enjoys working out, doing a lot of outdoor activities. He likes spending time with his family, and most importantly, he enjoys being a dad.
All right. Well, we certainly want to welcome you to the town of the Dime Star, Chief. Were you going to?
No, sir.
Oh, okay. you made a quick move there. You know, so. As I was saying, we certainly want to welcome you to the town of Vinton. We look forward to working with you. And I got to say, I'm impressed. You certainly come with a lot of credentials, and very impressed by the quality officers that you're attracting. So thank you for being here. And typically, council and staff would like to shake your hand as you come aboard.
Before we do that, Officer Jacob Miller will be pinned on.
Oh, okay. Yep.
By his daughters. Yep. Hold on a sec. I'll start you. Where I was taller than
Hey, I would just like to say real quick, that's the fastest that someone's pinned someone.
That's true.
That may be a rope.
It's tactical. It's just hanging.
Maybe it was coming. Welcome.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Well, glad to have you.
Welcome on, ma'am. Next, I'd like to invite Officer William Holland. Stay over there. So Officer William Holland serves with us for our Community Services Division. And recently he obtained a Crime Prevention Specialist certification. And I'm gonna talk about a little bit about that because it's quite prestigious and takes quite a bit of legwork to obtain it. So Crime Prevention Specialists play a pivotal role in designing and implementing strategies that mitigate the risk of crime. Their expertise is not only responding to criminal activities, but in proactively preventing them. This proactive approach is crucial as it helps to address the root cause of crime and reduces the likelihood of future incidents. One of the primary benefits, of course, of having a dedicated crime prevention specialist such as Officer Holland is their ability to analyze and understand local crime patterns. Their work often involves collaborating with law enforcement, community organizations, local businesses to create comprehensive crime prevention plans and tailored to the unique needs of a community. Moreover, crime prevention specialists are instrumental in fostering community engagement and education. They conduct he conducts workshops, seminars, outreach programs that inform residents about safety practices and crime prevention strategies. This educational component is essential as it empowers to take proactive steps in safeguarding themselves and their property. The presence of crime prevention specialists also build trust and strengthen relationships between law enforcement and the community by focusing on prevention rather than solely on the reaction of crime. These specialists promote a more positive and cooperative atmosphere. So recently, Officer Holland obtained his designation as a crime prevention specialist, a designation recognized by not only the Department of Criminal Justice, but the Commonwealth of Virginia. And in order to be considered for this designation, an officer has to serve or receive 40 hours of approved crime prevention training that covers areas such as theory and practice of crime prevention, personal safety, crime prevention through environmental design, and the ability to conduct security assessments. And moreover, the officer also has to receive an additional 80 hours of additional crime prevention training that addresses community policing, school safety and security, youth and family violence, public speaking, drug abuse prevention, and many more critical training criteria. And Officer Holland captures that best through one of his pamphlets he gives out to the community. When local businesses, citizens, and community groups and government agencies actively engage with each other, we develop a positive, lasting relationship, and we become active partners in safeguarding our neighborhoods. This teamwork creates a network of well-educated and vigilant eyes and ears that can only enhance the effectiveness of curbing crimes. Congratulations to you on your certification, sir.
Congratulations.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So appreciate
we certainly want to congratulate Officer Holland. We've had an opportunity to get to know him and understand the great work that he does, and just a real pleasure to be around.
Absolutely. So,
a great reputation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the job you're doing. Thank you.
Very quick, I meant to mention this in the beginning. You all have some patches. And they're going to be
for breast cancer awareness. However, that color is different. So the manufacturer is going to actually create ones that are pink. And those are unique and one of a kind because they were printed incorrectly. So enjoy.
Thank you.
So instead of throwing them away, you give them to us.
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
So more to follow on October as we got. As we capture breast cancer awareness and the wonderful projects that we did in the town, we want to capture that in October. Okay. So we'll actually have some patches that the officers will wear on their uniforms for the month. Moving on, I'd like to invite Officers Grant Shepherd and Officer Jesse Dibble to stand beside me.
Thank you, Chief. I like it.
Nearly perfect. The sanctity of life is the heart of every service-minded profession. Often in our profession, we're challenged with circumstances that are unbearably chaotic, where we engage with our fellow community members who are in despair and in desperate need of help. Our role is to maintain composure and offer a helping hand to those we serve when they need us the most. On May 21st, 2023, at 12:21 p.m., Officers Jesse Dibble and Officers Grant Shepherd were dispatched to a Screams for Help call for service. While the call type captured the seriousness of the call, dispatch was unable to give any context to responding officers because of the frantic caller. Initial information given the responding officers was that there was a lot of screaming in the background, there was calls for help, and the potential that someone was either bleeding or breathing. Or not breathing. Eventually, enough information was gathered to understand the even more seriousness of the call. An infant was unresponsive and not breathing. Upon arrival at 12:23 p.m., and to give further context, the call came out at about 12:21 and 34 seconds, I think, and the first responding officer was Officer Dibble at 12:23 and 7 seconds. So a minute and some change, and there was already an officer on scene. So responding officer met with family in distress. Despite the chaos, officers were immediate with their priorities and acted on the problem at hand, an 18-month-old infant not breathing. Upon arrival, Jesse Dibble, the first officer on scene, was given the child by a family member and promptly administered life-saving procedures. Second officer on scene, Officer Grant Shepherd, arrived on scene and aided Officer Dibble by holding the child in a more advantageous position to continue to perform life-saving measures. As a result of both of their actions, the infant regained consciousness and began breathing on her own. Through an officer's career, they will be called upon many times as a result of life-changing situations. They're expected to maintain composure, remain calm, and deal with the situation they are presented with tact, humility, and more importantly, resolve a problem to the best of their ability. And in this case, and like many others, their actions completely reshape the result of a call. Their actions illustrated by the officers are beyond exemplary. They are remarkable traits of a compassionate officers. Officer Dibble and Officer Shepherd exhibited the highest standard of excellence and compassion and treated a child as if they were their own. It is people like Officer Dibble and Officer Shepherd that make the world a better place, a safer place, through unwavering devotion to our community, our citizens, and of course, our children. Congratulations to you both.
Amen.
We will shake you guys, man.
Yes, we do.
Thanks, awesome. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Thank you.
That's
awesome.
Congratulations.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you for that presentation and all those details. And gentlemen, thank you for the job you're doing. And, you know, I just can't imagine many more professions or circumstances that would be more rewarding than what you folks did. And so thank you for sharing that with us. Way to go, guys. Good job.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you all. It's very hard to capture into words the emotional roller coaster that you go through when you're answering a call. As dispatch, of course, they're dealing with trying to gather information, and they have their own chaos between the lines of communication and responding officers. So the emotional roller coaster that you go through, your adrenaline, and being able to make tactful decisions is exemplary. to say the least.
Yeah.
Thank you both. And thank you all for allowing us to be up here and recognize them.
Anytime, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Council, I didn't mean to, if y'all want to say anything, Jeff.
You said it.
All right. So, boy, that's hard to follow, but Anita McMillan, I think she's got a few things for us from the planning and zoning. She'll explain an award.
You got this, Anita. You got this.
Good evening, Mayor Gross, members of the town council. I would like to recognize my associate planner, Fiola Gordon. She completed the Virginia chapter of the American Planning Association Leadership Development Program. This is a 6-month leadership program and is in Richmond. And basically, the participants engage in intensive conversation with a variety of instructors during the 3-hour monthly meetings. They had outside assignment to shadow or interview. In this case, she did interview me for that. And to, but the skill and techniques that leaders can integrate into their own leadership toolkits. In addition to the material covered, the student also forged relationship with one another. There are several participants from other locality. I'd like to mention what Mr. Andrew Hopwell, he is the Virginia Association Planning, the chapter president for the American Planning Association for the Virginia. He stated that for attendees like Fiola, a Richmond location made the meeting a full day event. Her commitment and dedication to the class was admirable and speak to her desire to improve her skill set and offer the citizens of Vinton the utmost service. Mr. Howard reached out to me and said that she represented herself very well and the town of Vinton should be proud of her. So I would like to recognize that. I do have that certificate.
Yeah, I think Vice Mayor.
And this young lady right here, Johnstone Hebrew.
Yeah.
She bird dogs at all costs. Grant money allows us to do a lot of different things in the town. So I want to give you a big round of applause.
Hey, if she gets a picture, Mike, you want to do it? Please, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good job.
Hey, oh, you got a. Good job.
I'm here again to recognize Roanoke County Comm IT, especially the GIS division. I do have several of them at the meeting this evening for the Virginia Association of Counties 2024 Achievement Award for them to help us with the Town of Vinton Stormwater Management Application Program. Back in June, if you recall, they also won the National Association of Counties Award. So basically, the application helped Fiola and Kenny that go out in the field to collect information all the on the stormwater outfall that is part of the requirement of the stormwater permit. I do have several representatives from Roanoke County Comm IT and the GIS here with us to be recognized for the award.
All right.
Go.
Are y'all with them?
Yeah.
Come on.
He got called out.
He's got to get all the glory.
That's right.
Wow.
I will say that is a hard act to follow with the police officer saving the child's life. So makes me proud to be part of this community. you know, so it gave me goosebumps. But this award here for Virginia Association of Counties is a hard award to win. That NACO award is not as, it's a national award, but the VACO, a little bit more prestigious. And in November, they are coming down. They're going to send a representative to give Anita and her team that award at the Board of Supervisors meeting. So y'all are welcome to. I'm glad to be here.
Thank you, folks. Thank you for what you do. I think she wants to take your picture there. So.
Might break that camera.
It's been through a lot.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you a lot and congratulations. We certainly appreciate the job you guys do. And Fayola, we didn't get a chance earlier, but we want to congratulate you. That's really awesome. So we appreciate the job that you're doing. And,
Absolutely. As
Councilmember McCarty mentioned, a couple months ago, if we can get you to do more presentations, we'd appreciate that. We love her accent. All right. Wow. We're doing a lot of celebrating here tonight. We have a great, it's just the indication of kind of staff that we have. We have an awesome staff that do a great job every day. They're all very professional, dedicated to their jobs, and they love this community, and that's really, really important. With that, we'll move on to citizen comments and petitions. This is section is for anything that's not listed on the agenda. So do we have anyone signed up tonight?
Mm-hmm. I have three people.
All right.
All right. Philip Bushy.
Evening, sir.
Good evening.
Can you follow all that?
Impressive. My name is Philip C. Bushy III, 183 Sanderson Ridge Court, Roanoke, Virginia, 24019-1208. Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of Town Council, and Vinton staff, thank you for this time again to explain the mission of Love Life Roanoke. You know we are a local chapter of a national organization whose mission is to unite the church against abortion and thus solve the human the orphan crisis. We applaud the ordinance that this council passed on September 3rd to limit the possibilities of another abortion clinic from opening here in the near future. Tonight, I speak of a recent happening at a Planned Parenthood facility witnessed and involving our Love Life Sidewalk team. A mom decided to postpone and then think some more about her decision to have an abortion at the Planned Parenthood on Peters Creek Road. They convinced her to reschedule so she could possibly get her money back. The mom's boyfriend was adamantly against this abortion, so much so that he was told by Planned Parenthood that he was not allowed in their building or on the property. He was told that he could come and stand with the protesters, that would be me, in the grass. The couple had driven there from Georgia the day before and had spent the night there. The mom came out to talk with him a couple times and we were able to pray with her. Although she agreed to go to Blue Ridge Women's Center, they did not go because they had another argument in their car. We have their numbers and have texted with them. We recommended a Christian pregnancy center for them in their home area, and they desire some Christian couple counseling, although he is a Muslim. Now, I report this not as a domestic emotion-packed happening coming to Vinton, but as a real-life, real-time situation already happening daily at our two abortion clinics. Emotion-packed domestic quarreling by out-of-state couples, where the only clinical counseling was the boyfriend, father, was told to leave the premises, and the mom was offered a rescheduling date but not a refund. Either way, Love Life counselors were there offering spiritual needs and Christian counseling referrals in their home area. We have already started our ongoing follow-up process with these folks and pray that the Lord resolves this so delicate but vital dispute amongst this couple. Until the citizens of our Commonwealth unite and demand from our state legislators legislation our governor can sign limiting Virginia's abortion window equal to or lower than our surrounding states, Virginia will remain the late-term abortion destination of the southeastern United States.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phil.
Gary Witt.
Thank y'all. My name is Barry Whipp from 3041 Woodway Road, Roanoke 24014. It was awesome to see the police department and how you honored those policemen tonight and for what they did. And the things that you wrote and spoke was tremendous. And I would just say if you go back and look at what he wrote, and apply it instead of an 18-month-old child to a 6-month child in the womb. What's the difference? I think some of you getting tired of us coming because I can see some faces, but I did have a question from Mayor, what you closed with last time. You said, if I heard you right, and I wanted to make clarification why I shared this, that y'all were not deceived. That you said you were not deceived. Is that true? You were not deceived.
I don't think so.
Okay, so the council was not deceived. They knew willingly, knowingly what they were going into.
Well, what I was talking about is when they came in for the zoning and they approached our folks in the planning department, they didn't tell any lies. They were not deceived. Council actually was not aware of any of that till much later. So we weren't involved. And I don't say that to dodge it, but that's the procedure. So.
Well, we got to make it clear, though, that abortion is not a question on the zoning permit. They answered all the questions as they are asked on the zoning permit.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anybody else want it?
I don't think we can say it any different, to be honest with you. I mean,
just giving
you know how I found out? Ann Russell called me. We don't get notification on every single business that comes to Benton, and that's a business, unfortunately. And it's zoned like it was supposed to, so that we've said it multiple times. There was nothing out of the ordinary until Ann Russell called me. I called Pete. None of us knew. So we've done what we can do.
Mr. Stave, I opened up to last week. Somebody had something, so we do have that tonight. But I do want to thank you for each time, and you know, that you allow us to speak and share. And it's because we have compassion, just like those officers. Thank you.
Thank you, Barry.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Ann Russell.
Hi, Ann.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. I'm Ann Russell. I live at 342 Stonebridge Drive in Vinton. I'm representing Blue Ridge Women's Center. And I have my husband who wants to, we don't know who to give it to, so he's going to hand out to everybody. We don't want anybody left out, okay?
Okay.
So I just wanted, he's handing you guys something that actually, Vice Mayor Stovall, last time there was a meeting, a town council meeting, you said you were open to anything that anybody had. So I think I want to thank you for that. I want to thank you for making that statement last time that you were open to any documents or anything anybody had. So I think what you said was, if you want us to listen, you got to get it to us, send it to us. Get it to us. So I'm giving it to everybody right now. What's before you is an ordinance to protect the health of mothers and unborn human life in the town of Vinton. I wanted you guys to have that because this was written by an attorney who actually deals with these issues on an ongoing basis. There's also a list there of multiple organizations who specialize in the issue of life who would be willing to represent you pro bono. You heard from multiple citizens over the last several weeks that, you know, we have your back. We want to be shoulder to shoulder with you on this. You've all stated that you really don't want abortion in Vinton. This is a way to make it not happen. And this list of law groups is there to help you in this whole process. Now's the time to do something that's hard. It's hard, but it's right. You've not had one person stand in front of you saying, yeah, we want this. You've had people from the town of Vinton say, we don't want it. We don't want it here in our town. And what you have in front of you is a way to potentially make this not happen. So I'm asking you to do what I stand up here and what these other people have stood up here and what I do every day of my life is what Proverbs 31:8 says, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. So that's what I'm asking you to do is to consider this ordinance. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Ann.
Let me, since my name was mentioned, just we'll take that to the next step. And I do appreciate you providing this to us. And of course, there's things in here, naturally. This information goes to that gentleman right over there, Mr. Carroll. And, you know, I mean, if you hit the highlights, I mean, there's in this one paragraph, it says the Constitution and laws of the Commonwealth. So it goes to him. The pro bono law firms go to him. And if he believes through his research that there's something that's viable, then he brings it back to council. And it's something that we look at. It's not a Mike Stovall decision. It's none of the decisions. We'd make that decision as a group. So I did say that because I've had people tell me you, when I talked to you on the phone, like Mr. Lyles. So that's where this goes, is to him for this current situation. Does that make sense?
I just want to make
sure. Oh, I got you. No, but does that make sense? Yeah.
Because you said if there was anything that could be.
Well, we would look at it. I mean, we've got to look at it. We should look at all evidence.
Thank you, Mr. Price, Mayor. Thank you, Ann. Are there any other speakers? That's okay. If you can come up to the microphone and give your name, Carmen.
Hi. I am Carmel Flippin, 715 Spruce Street, Vinton. I don't have an organization that I represent. My only credentials are that I am a Vinton resident that does not want this abortion facility in Vinton, that I am a woman who believes that abortion is one of the worst victimizations of women and one of the worst lies spread to women in the history of the world, and that I am a disabled person. I want to make sure that the council knows that for Down syndrome children alone, over 90% are aborted. That is the kind of success numbers that Nazi Germany could only dream of. And by allowing this facility in Vinton, you and I and every single person in Vinton becomes complicit in the genocide of disabled people. We have just over our border in Roanoke, Chris's Custard, run by a boy, a Down syndrome boy from our church, who I would say is probably the most popular person in our entire church. He is an incredible person. He is determined and ambitious and kind, and it is a great establishment if you have not been there. And it's just one example of what happens when human life is treated with dignity and respect. Now, I understand that this council has all made clear that they are not for this. When I was in college, I took a class called I Rest My Heart On. It was based on the word credo from the Bible, the Greek word, such as, you know, believe in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. The word credo means having faith in something in the way that you rest your heart on it. It's the difference between building a floor and saying it can be walked on and being the one that goes out and stands on it, sure you won't fall through. So what I'm saying to you now is I believe it when you're telling me that you do not want this. But if you truly believe that abortion is as horrible as we have all been telling you it is, you will not have an attitude of this is all that we can do. You will have an attitude of we will not stop until we find out what we can do. And that is what I'm asking you. You said this goes to him, but you also said you decide as a group. And you need to go beyond the most obvious solution to work with these organizations that Anne is telling you about to say what are possible solutions that work within the law to stop this. Because we do all have the blood of all of those children on our hands. And I know I will not be able to sleep. And I hope that you will not be able to sleep until we have stopped this. Thank you so much for all the good that you have done today. Thank you so much for all the good you do on this council. I do appreciate you, and I want you to know that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Anyone else?
No.
All right. Thank you for your comments tonight. With that, we will move on to our reports from the committees. Bo Herndon.
There you are.
Public Works Committee.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, Bo.
Mayor and members of council, we had a Public Works Committee meeting September the 11th. Due to the items that we talked about was, first of all, was sign replacements. Of course, we're going through the town, as y'all know, replacing signs, street signs, and warning signs. We started in Midway, which we are about 95% completed in Midway. We had some off-the-wall signs that we had to order. So once we get them in, which they came in today, we'll get them up and then we'll be completely done with that section. We are currently also in the Valley High section of town and working, and we have put our order in for the Dillon Woods and the neighborhood behind Kroger's on Norborn. We have ordered all them signs. Sign replacement's going pretty good. They're looking good too, so it's a big difference for sure. We talked about signal lights. The blinking yellows have been put in at Washington and Bypass and also at Virginia and Pollard. So they are working pretty good. That's only two intersections that we've done. We looked at line of sight issues on all the other intersections, and that's really about the only two intersections that we was able to do with the blinking yellow. And then the PFG light. So as you know, it's been knocked down. They do not make poles, a four-post pole like was there. So we had to go to find one, which we went to the city of Radford. I was able to get one from them. And the contractor has ordered new signal light heads. And just like every time we order anything when it comes to signal lights, they'll be here at Christmas. So hopefully, so they'll be in at Christmas. We'll have it signal light back online. And then also we have reached out to our contractor that came in and helped us set the GPS synchronizing up. And once PFG gets completed, he'll come in after Christmas and we're going to go through all 11 intersections again and get the timing and right. And then also to get a new software that helps us download everything in each intersection, so if anything ever happens to them, we can just go back to the intersection with a thumb drive, place it in there, and it'll automatic reset it for us. And then we can control it and do different things with it, so that'll be a pretty good system.
Yeah.
Also signal lights Niagara Road and Hardy. That camera system went bad, so it's in recall, so it's not working properly. That camera has got here. It's at the shop being programmed as we speak. Maybe not as we speak, but sometime this week. Hopefully to get that in within the next 30 days, so that signal light will be functioning correctly. Niagara Road, the Western Virginia Water Authority has been putting that sewer line in. They're about 20% done. They've put in about 60 foot of pipe and two different manholes. So it's slow, but it's a pretty big project, really, considering the depth of the old sewer line. It's about 30 foot deep, so that makes it a little bit slower to work with. Paving, we have awarded to Superior contractors. Talked with them, had our pre-construction meeting, and looks like possibly springtime before we can get some of our roads repaved. In the Valley High section of town is where we're really concentrating on. There's some other streets too that we're still working and trying to fine tune. They talked about maybe possibly coming in the fall. But only give us 2 weeks, so I kind of said, hey, let's just hold off and let's just do it in the spring. I didn't want to bring everybody in here for 2 weeks and get started, and then we get a cold snap and, you know, not get nothing done at all. So look for that in the springtime, and I will keep everybody up to date when that comes. Stormwater projects, we had a bid opening for Thrasher Church. That happened on September the 11th. So that bid's in, so we're overlooking them bids, and we'll get with Pete and Cody and figure out how that's going to work. And then also to the intersection of South Pollard and Jefferson, that stormwater project, we are going out to bid, and we should go out to bid within 30 days. Mm-hmm. We talked about 3rd Street. As you well know, that's like a roller coaster coming through there. We're going to get with some engineers, and hopefully sometime this fall or early spring, we're going to get some bore samples in and then try to get with VDOT and try to come up with a plan to rebuild or fix 3rd Street. We've talked to VDOT. It's not a good FDR project because that road is settling. It seems like it settles every single day. It gets deeper and deeper. Mm-hmm. So we'll get with VDOT and hopefully come up with a plan to get that road in better shape. And then Gus Nix and Garfright Bridge, we had our bi-yearly inspection by Manor and Craig. The work that we'd done there in 2 years ago is holding up well. Our bridge has rated as a 7, which is very well. Usually a brand new bridge a year after it's built comes in as an 8 usually. So we come in as a 7. We've talked about some our next step in the next couple of years of redecking it and doing some things like that to make it better. But as of right now, it's in good standing. It's a 7. Also kind of tied in with Garfright Bridge, Roanoke City has up their road diet plan for Gus Nix from Orange Avenue into the town limits. It was supposed to be a 2027 project. It looks like it's going to be a 2025 project. So me, Pete, and Cody has called Roanoke City, and we're trying to work out something where we can just piggyback off their contract and go off their design and then do a shared cost with that, so we can continue that to the intersection of Pollard and Gus Nix. And that'll tie into some stuff with the bridge as well, because we want to tie off the Greenway right there at Billy Bird Apartments and come across the bridge. So there'll be some good thought about that. It looks like we're probably going to have to get together pretty quickly about it, because spring is really around the corner, right at Christmas. And then
next week.
Yeah, well, definitely. And then the last thing that I have is our refuse truck is in Roanoke. It's not in the town, but it is in Roanoke. I have seen a picture of it, and it looks very cool. So new, it's new and shiny and pretty wheels on it. Hopefully it's in the shop. They got to do a couple of things. We should receive it next week.
Oh, all right. That's good.
That's all I have. Any questions?
After our meeting the other day, I had mentioned something about Meadows and wonder when we were going to get the paving. Well, they did it like that afternoon or even the next day.
Yeah, that's
so how it, right looks now. Very good.
It does look good.
Good job. Yeah. I was like, yeah, yeah. Oh, I know. It was crazy how quick that happened. But anyway, it's done. So
that's a good great committee right there.
Get stuff done. Yeah,
and on behalf of a husband and wife that lives in the town, job well done on the loop behind 107 with the 2-hour parking. Oh. They honed in on a couple of cars. They supported me for a long time and sent me a couple of pictures and kept sending pictures. Loved to eat at 107. Kept taking pictures of the cars and they would time stamp them and date stamp them, you know, so it wouldn't. So finally, they did send me. Of course, I called them and talked to them. But anyway, they were proud. I mean, they sent me a picture. That's how I knew about it. Next thing I know, well, he sent the email. I didn't see the email, but they sent me a picture of the sign. So they love it. They love it. So anyway, thank you for that.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out the best way to put them in. I just didn't want to just stick them in the ground. So I was like, let's put some concrete ballards. And second day, somebody already hit one of the ballards.
That's all right.
Oh. Sign did not move. We chipped the paint. But other than that, the sign
and the cars are moved. We're in the new parking lot.
Yeah, for sure.
So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Yes, sir.
Good job. Good report, sir.
Yeah, good report.
Thanks, man. Yeah. You guys are really staying busy. Certainly appreciate the job you guys are doing. Good committee. All right. So we'll move on to the Finance Committee. Andrew?
Right. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. The Finance Committee met yesterday, September 16th, and we looked at activity through the end of August. With August being only the second month in the fiscal year, it's too early to identify any major trends that we could follow. However, the revenues in the consumer categories, which are going to be our meals, our sales tax, our paramutual are exceeding budget. And next month I will give a breakdown by revenue category to show exactly how those are performing each individual category, so we can look at those through the quarter. Meals tax especially is doing well. We've got two new restaurants that have come into the town since the budget revenue category had been made for the FY25 budget. We've had Marco's Pizza come in and then Panda Boba. So in addition to just the restaurants continuing to perform well as far as sales go, we've got two new ones that weren't necessarily in consideration when we were putting the budget together. This far in the fiscal year, we'd like to see about 16.5% to 17% of revenue earned. We're at 18%, which is a little high, and that's a good thing. We haven't yet had a major tax collection period. You know, the next one's going to go out in October. The second half real estate for the first half of the fiscal year. So to be exceeding in the revenue, the consumer categories alone is impressive, and it's a good thing that we hope we can ride throughout the year. Grant fund remains in a negative position of a couple hundred thousand, which it typically does, as we're constantly waiting for project reimbursements. The capital fund remains strong. We're still continuing to earn in excess of $50,000 a month on the funds that we keep there that are diversified across our investment banks. So that is exciting. We're going to ride that out as long as we can. I know you all have seen that there's been discussion about the lowering of rates going forward. So we'll see how that impacts us and make any necessary moves that we can to continue the earnings that we're seeing there, at least to the best of our ability. We did talk about budget transfers and rollovers. Cody's going to discuss that just in a moment in a public hearing, so I'll leave that up to him. Bo touched on the Thrasher Church project. We have, of course, received the quotes for that, and I guess Pete and Cody will be in discussion with the church leadership there. Lastly, we touched on the History Museum. We had talked about Fayola earlier and some of the grants that she secured. She was able to secure a $42,000 grant for their lift system project. So that $42,000 that she was able to get through the grant, coupled with the around $60,000 that they had in cash puts their current funding for that project at over $100,000. So their fundraising efforts are going to continue through the end of the year, and hopefully we can see them bring that project to fruition at some point. Do y'all have any questions?
That's great.
All right. Well, with that being said, I'd ask that you all consider the adoption of the August financial statements.
So moved.
All right.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to accept the financial statement. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign.
Mr. Mayor, did you have something else there?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm good. All right. With that, we'll move on to our public hearing for this evening. And of course, it's concerning the proposed amendments to the Town of Vinton budget. And as per usual, I will open the public hearing. We'll have a report from staff, take comments, and then council. So I'll officially open the public hearing. And Cody, I guess you're going to do the report.
Yes, sir. Mr. Mayor, members of Town Council. So it has become sort of customary in sort of the order of business that around August, September of each year, once the new fiscal year has begun and looking back over the previous fiscal year, we do an analysis of projects and other sort of operational expenditures that for one reason or another we just didn't get to in the previous fiscal year. In some instances, as is tonight with the police department's computer and other technology equipment. This is a conversation that began a number of months ago where for various reasons they elected to defer the purchase of their equipment from last year because of some software updates that they knew were coming down the pike, and then do a double purchase in this fiscal year, looking to roll over that money. In other instances, it's we're waiting on information from a grant. So up for consideration tonight is the Wolf Creek Greenway bathroom project, which Anita will be addressing later on this evening. But we had budgeted the money for the town's match for that grant last fiscal year. We have been successfully notified that we received that grant, and so we roll the money forward along with appropriating the new money. And then also listed tonight, the multi-generational park project, which we had always anticipated to be a multi-year project as well. So we had put approximately $250,000 into the budget in FY24. We've spent a decent amount of that money doing some pre-purchase of playground equipment that will be installed later in the fall. And so the action being requested tonight is to take that remaining money of the $153,000 from last year and pull it into this year in order to give our capital project staff flexibility to continue to move on with that project throughout the fiscal year. So you have before you a resolution and a list of these appropriations and transfers. Running through them just very quickly, the vast majority of the money as listed for tonight are rollovers. It's old money coming from FY24 into FY25. We have a little bit of new additional money, which we are pulling from interest on investments. As Mr. Keen noted, our interest on investments is doing quite well, has already been proven to do quite well, so we feel comfortable pulling from that money this early in the fiscal year, and that's to offset some of those police expenditures where we needed just a little extra money to make them whole, and then some extra grant match money from that grant for the Wolf Creek Greenway project. Like I said, and then the remaining $177,000 is the federal revenue reimbursement grant. So that's new money coming into us from a grant, which of course you need to appropriate that revenue in order for us to spend it. So it's a grand total of $462,000 across the general grant and capital funds. Like I said, the majority of it is rollover money, so it's old money just moving from one fiscal year to another, with new money being small amount on that interest and investments, and then the revenue grant. I'm happy to take any questions, although I would note at the advice of Mr. Carroll, one amendment that I would suggest in the resolution, draft resolution in your packet, at the now be it resolved line, replacing the word transfer with the words amend the budget.
Okay.
And that will be taken care of in future budget presentations.
Thank you.
Copy and paste is your favorite. Okay. So if you have any questions on these, happy to answer them, and would offer the resolution with that one amendment.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Any public comment? No. So, council, any questions, discussion? Nope. Hearing none, I'll officially close the public hearing. And you have before you a resolution that would approve the proposed amendments to the Town of Benton budget as described by Cody and the wording as amended.
Thank you, sir.
Did I get that, Jeremy? Jeremy.
I'll make a motion to approve the amended.
All right.
And I'll second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Lyle, second by Councilmember McCarty. Please call the roll.
Councilmember Lyles?
Yes.
Councilmember McCarty?
Yes.
Councilmember Mullins?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Stovall?
Yes.
Mayor Gross?
Yes.
All right. So the amendment, the resolution does pass. All right, we'll move on to other items that will require action. And Anita, I see you're ready to go.
Yes, sir. Mayor Gross, members of the council. As Cody mentioned earlier, we were notified by Virginia Department of Conservation and Recreation that we received the Recreational Trail Program Fund in the amount of $177,217.78 that we submitted in April 2024. It is a reimbursable program, so the resolution is for council to accept the grant and also to appropriate money for the project. This is for the Wolf Creek Greenway accessible restroom. So will be two for women and men restroom. And as far as 80-20, so the grant will cover 80% of the grant, and the town cash of capital improvement project will cover the 20%, which is about $44,000. And this 20% match can also, the town, we are planning to use public work personnel and equipment, and those can be counted toward this $44,000. So, and I just like to mention that Jamie Hurt, the capital project manager, Frank McGuire, the Greenway coordinator, helped me with the grant application. So I thank them for that. So looking forward to get this project going. We just have to do several federal requirements. It is federal money. So we are having a meeting in October with the vendor that is a federal government GSA vendor that has been approved by DCR. And we hope to place an order by end of October. And hopefully, the project will be completed by spring of next year.
Awesome.
So, and if Mayor Gross recall, Wolf Creek Greenway was the first greenway in the town, and it was funded by DCR.
Yes.
So most of the greenway in Roanoke Valley are funded by VDOT fund, but this is from DCR grant. So it's kind of full circle. So we're going to complete it with the DCR grant for the restroom. I'll be happy to answer any question that you may have.
That is full circle.
Nice.
Thank you very much for that report. Council, you have any questions, comments?
Mr. Mayor, before you finish up, I do have a slight change to that resolution, kind of like what Cody did.
Okay.
So I could wait till you're finished up before you get a motion in.
I was just going to say I really appreciate the report, the presentation, but you included in there a couple of details that really reflect the teamwork we have going on here in town. You know, Public Works is involved, our project manager, Jamie, and then, of course, you guys have done a lot of work in the planning department. It's really a team effort. I think that's awesome, and I congratulate you folks on that. It's awesome. Thank you for that. Yes, sir.
And Mr. Mayor, what I was going to propose is an amendment to the resolution simply to reflect that I know staff, Pete, Anita, others have done a lot already to advance this grant application and executed documents. And sometimes when that happens, it's good to add language. And I would ask that this resolution have language such as, and be it further resolved that the town council ratifies and approves of the acts taken by town staff to execute documents and deliver documents in furtherance of the resolution. Just to yes. Make sure that we're blessed everything that they've done.
Great. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Jeremy.
If that mayor wants to go ahead and make that resolution.
No, that's important, Jeremy. I appreciate you doing that.
Gee, I did not send it to Mr. Carroll for his review. So, I only send the other three items.
Yeah. Okay, folks, you've heard all the information and the resolution as corrected by our council. Is there a motion? Well, first of all, any questions, comments? Nope. Motion?
Great work.
I'll make a motion to adopt the resolution with that small amendment.
Very good.
Second.
Or large amendment. Amendment.
Good side.
Good size amendment.
Small because they did a lot of work. Good size amendment.
All right, so we have a motion that would approve the amendment and, a motion that would accept the funds actually as described by Anita. And Mike, did you second that?
Yes, sir.
And we do have a second, so if you'll call a roll, please.
Councilmember Lyles?
Yes.
Councilmember McCarty?
Yes.
Councilmember Mullins?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Stovall?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Second one?
All right.
The ordinance? Okay. Just a brief history. If you recall, in 2003, the town became, being a dense locality, 3.2 with 8,000 population, we fell under the Federal Clean Water Act as far as the Municipal Separate Stormwater Sewer System, what everybody call it MS4. And we didn't, as far as since Roanoke County is the town storm erosion sediment control authority since 1984, but then when we became MS4 in 2016, basically in 2014, we have to adopt Virginia Stormwater Ordinance, and we basically back then we have to hire private engineering firm to review all the site plan, regarding the stormwater management. And from 2014 to 2016, the town and the county worked together to end DEQ for the county to also be the town Virginia Stormwater Program Authority in addition to the erosion sediment control. And in 2016, the town entered a memorandum of understanding with Roanoke County for the county to be the town erosion sediment control and Virginia Stormwater Program Authority. Last year, 2023, the State Water Control Board basically required all locality to consolidate the erosion sediment control ordinance and stormwater management to become one combined ordinance. So the county, Roanoke County Board Supervisor adopted the combined erosion and stormwater management ordinance in July to become effective in July. And then since the county was the town erosion and Virginia stormwater, we also have to we also have to meet their requirement. And since we also is the MS4 permit community, we also have to adopt the combined erosion and stormwater program ordinance. So I know it's just a mouthful, all of these things. So Mr. Peters and we work with Roanoke County, and they agree to also become our Virginia erosion and Stormwater Program Authority. So I do, in order for them to, in order for us to, for the county to become the town authority for this combined ordinance, we do have to adopt Roanoke County Stormwater Ordinance, as I mentioned earlier. So I do have before you an ordinance to amend the town Stormwater Ordinance, and then to adopt the to adopt Roanoke County Combined Erosion and Stormwater Program Ordinance, so VESM. So I do have before you the ordinance in front as amended. So basically, we adopt the ordinance as a reference and then as amended. So anytime Roanoke County amended the ordinance, we do not have to do that every time. So I do have before you. And Mr. Carroll did review what we submitted to him. So regarding the ordinance, so I'll be happy to answer any question, or if Mr. Carroll want to add anything to that.
No, happy to answer any questions, but no, we're gonna need a cover.
Okay, really good explanation. Appreciate that. Because some of this stuff gets a little complicated. Did you have something to say? No. Okay. Gosh, maybe I should wait till after meeting. I have something somewhat related, but the MS4, I'm just curious, not all communities are considered MS4 because they don't have separate stormwater and sewer systems. Is that right?
It depends on the population threshold, like Roanoke County, certain part of Roanoke County is covered by the MS4. Like Cave Spring, Windsor Hill, it's based on the population per square miles. Like Blacksburg, the town of Vinton, you know, we all are MS4 because of the number of population in that square, in that size of the community.
And what, to me, what makes this significant is back in the day, it was kind of common to have stormwater and sewer together, right?
Way
back in the day.
Correct. Like Lynchburg, they have combined sewer and stormwater.
Yeah.
And then since then, you know, most locality have to have separate. Basically, you do not, you don't have a combined system of the sanitary sewer system and stormwater, because stormwater go directly to the creek.
Right.
Sanitary sewer go to the wastewater treatment to be treated before they release to the creek waterways. And all the creek in Roanoke Valley and in the town, we are surrounded by four water: Roanoke River, Wolf Creek, Tinker Creek, Glade Creek, and all are those fall under the impact water and what they call it pollution diet. So those are the sediment, the bacteria. We are allocated by the EQ, like how much those pollution can be need be treated in order to meet the Clean Water Act.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Sorry, Council, to get off on that. I just think that's so important and significant, you know. So, okay. Yeah, before you, an ordinance as described by Anita concerning the stormwater management for the town of Vinton. I think I'll stop there. is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to adopt.
Second.
All right. We have a motion by Councilmember McCarty, second by Councilmember Lyles. Any questions, comments? Do we do a roll call on this? Okay, if you would please.
Councilmember Lyles?
Yes.
Councilmember McCarty?
Yeah.
Councilmember Mullins?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Stovall?
Yes.
Mayor Gross?
Yes. Thank you.
Since we have adopted Roanoke County or combined ordinance, now we have to basically enter a new MOU, because the two MOUs we have now is separated. Now we have to combine the erosion sediment and the stormwater management ordinance into one. So I do have before you the MOU that, and also the resolution for council to authorize Meter Peters, the town manager, to enter agreement with the county to for the county to be the town VESM authority. And Mr. Carroll has basically reviewed both the resolution and the MOUs, and I have also forwarded the MOUs to Roanoke County, and they do not have any changes to the MOUs.
Okay, great. Cool. Council, any questions? Moment? Nope. All right.
I'll so move the resolution.
Thank you, sir.
I'll second.
All right, we have a motion for the resolution by Vice Mayor Stovall and a second by Council Member Mullins. Please call the roll.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Councilor McCarty?
Yes.
Councilor Mullins?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Stovall?
Yes.
Mayor Gross?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Anita.
Thank you.
Good job on a complicated subject.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jeremy.
All right. Very good. A team effort, right?
Yep.
Yeah. All right, we'll move on to a reappointment we have to RVTV this evening, and I believe our town clerk has been nominated, if I should say that, or will have you agreed to serve again?
Me.
That's all.
I have Ray Sandifer, who wants to be reappointed to Roanoke Valley Regional Cable TV Committee for another 3-year term beginning September 1st and ending August 31st, 2027. Backtrack, because we had the last meeting was very busy, we decided to have it at this one instead, and he was fine with that.
Yeah, so you've contacted him?
Yes.
I was just kidding about you, sir.
She could.
Yeah, she could. That's right. All right, folks, we have an appointment to make Ray Sandifer to RVTV. A motion?
I'll make a motion.
Okay. I'll second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor of reappointing Ray Sandifer, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. You've been busy this evening, Jeremy, but I don't see anything else listed.
No, you're correct, Mr. Mayor, but I will add, I just so council is aware, the information that Mrs. Russell circulated earlier, that is either identical to or certainly very similar to something I believe she had given to Mr. Peters previously.
Yeah.
So I have seen that before, and that has factored into analysis that I have undertaken previously. I don't want to get into my analysis and legal advice in a public setting, needless to say, but I just wanted y'all to be aware that that is something I have, I have seen and considered.
All right. So you are already aware of that.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you for that. And thank you for wearing that spiffy tie. You're setting a standard we need to live up to, Jeremy. with that, we will move on to town manager's project updates.
I just quickly have a couple updates. Wanted to, and it was already mentioned tonight, the Pink Warrior Walk that was held just a few weeks ago, but I want to acknowledge Antonia's contributions and her idea, actually, to start that event, and also Councilwomen Laurie and Sabrina for serving on that committee. I was not able to attend that day. I was out of town, but I heard it was quite an event. 206 participants the first year, and raised nearly $7,000. So over $7,000 towards the cause. So just want to acknowledge these ladies and a lot of staff in the town who participated in the event to pull it together. So pretty remarkable for a first year event. So just wanted to again acknowledge their efforts.
Yeah.
I also wanted to just inform council that the deputy town manager and I attended a joint work session of the subcommittee for the House and the Senate today in Richmond regarding historical horse racing terminals, which is essentially Rosie's. I'll keep council informed of any further information that we receive on that, but we went as a precaution to just be visible and be present to make sure that Vinton Rosie's and Vinton locality was represented, and we received some, I think, positive information today, and it could stand to be even more positive as the conversations continue. But I just want to let you know that we represented the town today and appreciate Cody and Andrew both their
keeping a very close eye on any discussions about the casinos and HHR, just in the sense of how it does benefit our public infrastructure and how we utilize those revenues to make our community better. So, but I'll keep you informed on that. And I just wanted to, call attention to the comprehensive plan survey. That information, the public survey is still out. Nita, what's the date on that?
Extended to the end of the month.
Oh, yes. Yeah, 300 survey responses.
Yeah. I mean, 300?
300.
Wow.
Cool. So I know council has received that information before, so make sure you send that out to your contacts. It is on all of our socials. It's on our website. We've got it in public places. There's QR codes. There's web links. So there's plenty of opportunities for the citizen to provide feedback. And then I just wanted to kind of recognize that we're planning to have a joint work session on October 1st. Because we did consider other official town business, we will not hold an actual council meeting on October 1st, and it will be a joint work session only regarding the subject. So we will meet, but it will be just a work session.
Right.
With the Planning Commission.
Right.
And that is all I have this evening. Thank you.
All right. So you guys been to Richmond and back today?
Yeah.
How long was that meeting?
40, 50 minutes.
Bless your hearts.
But well worth it.
Well worth the trip. I got you. No, I'm with you. Well worth going.
Cody and I got some good time in the car today. We did conduct a lot of good business, so we made efficient use of our time and together.
Very good. Well, I'm glad you guys could make it back tonight. That's awesome. Yeah. Okay, Council, it's your turn. Mr. Vice Mayor, we can start with you.
I just got one thing back to the breast cancer walk. Of course, I was out of town with my wife on a honeydew that she asked me to do, but I received, which I thought was great, 3 phone calls from individuals that do not live in the town of Benton that did participate, talked about you and the two of you, the two council members, of course, and how great it was. And just they met some people they didn't know, but anyway, hats off to you for that. I mean, for the idea, and then of course pushing it across the finish line for the first year, $7,000 is nothing to sneeze at. And to me, the litmus test of it is that when you get people outside of Benton that come to Benton for it and say how great it was, congratulations.
Pretty cool.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Ma'am, yeah. And to be back on full map, my best friend came from Richmond.
Oh.
For it. We had the best weather, the best time. And Tony, thank you for jump starting that. And it was fun to see, and I've got already some ideas for next. But it was wonderful. Thank you. And thank you for the town staff, because you worked your butts off.
All right.
And I also want to thank the staff. You guys are so educated, so on top of it. Just to hear us go through these things, and there were some complicated things Anita went over. I don't think people realize we get, like, this agenda packet is 92 pages of what we are going to talk about tonight, what we're going to do, and we've had it over the weekend to look at it. And that's a lot of work for the staff to put in for us to be well prepared like we are. And I appreciate that so very much, because you make us look like movie stars. So, thank you very, very much.
We'll be sending autographs later, right? Maybe.
As I'm looking on here, it's September the 20th, which is Friday. The fall golf tournament is going to be at Botetourt Golf Club for the Vinton Chamber. And I'm sure if you want to get a team together, they'll still take you on. Or if you got anything for goodie bags, you're always looking for goodie bags. A shout out for a restaurant this week. It's Famous Anthony's. I had breakfast there with a few friends. It was very good. I too have on here to say thank you for all your hard work with the breast cancer walk. I've heard nothing but, you know, raving reviews. Everybody was very appreciative of what we did for a first year event. That went pretty seamless, I think. And I mean, there are some ideas for next year, but I think it'll just grow from this point. So thank you for your idea and for your hard work. Great job to the police department and to Faye. And I think I've mentioned this one other time, but we had these in our packets. Is there any way we can get these in, like, the museum and anywhere that could, like, we could circulate them, or I mean, I don't know if we can sell them. I don't know. I mean, like, I always look for one in the drugstores or whatever when I'm out of town.
I got one.
Just in. So I don't know what we can do, but anyway, I think they're cool, and I
yes,
think
they are.
People need to see them.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I have.
Sure. Anything further?
Not a whole lot. Just great job on the walk. I didn't get to make it either. I was working that day later, and my day was over with. But I heard it was a very successful event, and it sounds like it was. So $7,000 is a lot of money to raise and for a first event.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how about some pink lemonade next year?
Woohoo!
Pretty please.
Pink pretty lemon. Pink lemon.
Thanks, Chief, for bringing that story to us. That, you know, had you guys not done that, well, you never knew that stuff. And it's a great, it shows the what an awesome police department that we have and how fast we are, because that was something that was, timing was of an issue. We said in less than a minute, or right at a minute.
Some things.
Yeah, so really great story, and great way to recognize those two also.
Thank you.
Yeah, and thanks for my patch.
Thank and you. They wonder what the patch mark. Get the correct one.
And the camera.
Okay, thank you, sir. I won't repeat too much of that, but just briefly, I thank you for the patch, and I would the story was overwhelming, and I'd like to just comment again on the quality of officers that you're attracting here to the town. I think it's awesome. It's just doing a great job, and just to our staff in general, you know, you guys jump in and organize things like the walk, and there's a lot of teamwork going on, and I just want to once again thank our staff for the awesome job they do. We certainly have a well-qualified staff, but more than that, they work together as a team, and I think that's really important. I think a lot of that's due to the leadership, too, so thank you, sir, for the job you guys are doing. One other thing I wanted to mention briefly, and I'm a little bit late on this. I wanted to do it last council meeting and didn't get around to it. But our very own Debbie Adams was recognized by the Lions Club for her community service. And Lions Club did a great job, by the way. And so, Debbie, I just want to kind of tag on to that and thank you for everything you do for this community. I think one of the really big changes, it's hard to quantify, not everyone realizes it, is just the general attitude and the atmosphere in this town is so much better than it was in years past. And I give you a lot of credit for that, Debbie. You always report things in a positive manner, even though you have to tell it like it is. You always approach it. And I just thank you for your professionalism. Speaking of that, you guys, if you're animal lovers, have probably seen action photos of animals and dogs. And in case you missed this, I brought my paper back. I won't pass this around. Debbie took this photo of the dog days up there at Lancelot, I guess, of this dog jumping into the to the pool. Yes, thank you, sir. And what a professional shot. I mean, she caught the dog in midair there, and I thought that was just so cool. So I wanted to make sure.
The dog looked at her before she took it and said, "You're gonna want to get hit."
Debbie was there and ready, and that's the whole story.
Remember that event? It is it's a really good event.
I need to go to that.
Yeah,
go enjoy that.
Yeah, isn't that a good?
Love it.
Absolutely.
Debbie said, "Oh, it's luck."
And the other dog's face. There's Debbie's dog standing right here, and somebody's going, "I can't believe you're doing that."
It was great, and I thought I was really impressed with that. So anyhow, small town stuff, right?
Small town stuff.
All right. Is there anything else to come before council this evening? If not, we will entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All right. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by leaving. Thank you, folks. God bless you.